Welcome back to our daily reading of Luther's Large Catechism. Today is August 3rd, 2020. I hope you had a wonderful weekend, but I want to thank you for joining me for this devotion. We're going to pick up where we left off with the Sixth Commandment here shortly, and then also look at our psalmody from Psalm 16. Let us begin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. A reading from Psalm 16. Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. As for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. The sorrows of those who run after another god shall multiply. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel in the night. Also my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure. For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand our pleasures forevermore. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. As I said, we will be continuing our look at the Sixth Commandment, and we took half of it last time, and in that commandment, we read how highly Luther views the estate of marriage, and we'll get into this a little bit here in just a few moments. He says that that really marriage, the estate of marriage, should be so highly esteemed that it should be above all authority, both authority in the church and in the government, in the civil and churchly authority. Marriage is to be honored as higher than these estates. So it really goes contrary to maybe what a lot of us think. We think that that really someone is I guess you could say closer to God or doing more of God's work if you take up church work. But Luther says something very different. He says that that really the highest estate, the thing that should be honored above all things, is God's gift of marriage. And so so he says everything flows from that. All authority, all government, all church authority really flows from the estate of marriage. And so it is so highly esteemed in Luther's eyes. And therefore he condemns those who are forced into celibacy, or at least the vow of celibacy. He said, you know, you're free now because forced celibacy in Luther's eyes is not a good thing. And then he goes on to say that really husbands and wives ought to love one another and honor each other as well. So we're going to take up the second half of the Large Catechism, the Sixth Commandment. Luther writes, I have always taught that this estate should not be despised nor held in disrepute, as is done by the blind world and our false church leaders. Marriage should be regarded as it is in God's Word, where it is adorned and sanctified. It is not only placed on an equality with other estates, but it comes first and surpasses them all, emperor, princes, bishops, or whatever they please. For both church and civil estates must humble themselves and all be found in this estate, as we shall hear. Therefore, it is not a peculiar estate, but the most common and noblest estate that runs through all Christendom. Yes, it extends through all the world. In the second place, you must know also that marriage is not only an honorable, but also a necessary state. In general and in all conditions, it is solemnly commanded by God that men and women who were created for marriage shall be found in this estate. Yet there are some expectations, although few, whom God has especially set apart. They are not fit for the married estate. Or there are individuals whom he has released by a high supernatural gift so that they can maintain chastity without this estate. See Matthew 19:11-12. For where nature has its course, since it is given by God, it is not possible to remain chaste without marriage. See 1 Corinthians 7. For flesh and blood remain flesh and blood. The natural desire and excitement have their course without delay or hindrance, as everybody sees and feels. In order, therefore, that it may be easier in some degree to avoid inchastity, God has commanded the estate of marriage. In this way, everyone may have his proper portion and be satisfied with it. Yet God's grace is also required in order that the heart may be pure. From this, you see how this popish rabble, priests, monks, and nuns, resist God's order and commandment. For they despise and forbid matrimony, and they dare and vow to maintain perpetual chastity. Because this, they deceive the simple-minded with lying words and appearances, for no one has so little love and desire for chastity as these very people. Because of great sanctity, they avoid marriage and either indulge in open and shameless prostitution or secretly do even worse, so that one dare not speak of it. Unfortunately, this has been learned too fully. In short, even though they abstain from the act, their hearts are so full of unchaste thoughts and evil lusts that there is a continual burning and secret suffering which can be avoided in the married life. See 1 Corinthians 7:9. Therefore, all vows of chastity outside of the marriage state are condemned by this commandment. Free permission to marry is granted. Indeed, even the command is given to all poor ensnared consciences that have been deceived by their monastic vows. Abandon the unchaste state and enter the married life. They must consider that even if the monastic life were godly, it would still not be in their power to maintain chastity. And if they remain in their monastic vows, they must only sin more and more against this commandment. Now I speak of this in order that the young may be guided so that they desire the married estate and know that it is a blessed estate and pleases God. For in this way, over time, we might cause married life to be restored to honor. There might be less of the filthy, loose, disorderly ends that now run riot the world over in open prostitution and other shameful vices arising from disregard for married life. Therefore, it is the duty of parents and the government to see to it that our youth are brought up with the discipline and respectability. When they have become mature, parents and government should provide for them to marry in the fear of God and honorably. God would not fail to add his blessing and grace so that people would have joy and happiness from marriage. Let me now say in conclusion what this commandment demands. Everyone should live chaste in thought, word, and deed in his condition, that is, especially in the estate of marriage. But also everyone should love and value the spouse God gave him. See Ephesians 5:33. For where marital chastity is to be maintained, man and wife must by all means live together in love and harmony. the one may cherish the other from the heart and with complete faithfulness. For harmony is one of the principal points that enkindles love and desire for chastity, so that, where this is found, chastity will follow without any command. Therefore, St. Paul diligently encourages husband and wife to love and honor one another. Here you have again precious, indeed, many and great good works. You can joyfully boast about them against all churchly estates chosen without God's word and commandment. So here again, Luther emphasizes the importance of the marriage estate, and that really it is to be viewed as highly as any other, even above all others, in civil and church authority. And he says how the importance of living a chaste life, and how husbands and wives should love and honor one another. And really all authority, again, going back to the fourth commandment, if you remember back to the fourth commandment, how all authority in the civil realm and in the church realm really flow from God's gift of marriage. And so there you have it, the sixth commandment, dealing with adultery and dealing with living a chaste life and God's gift of marriage. We're going to dive into the seventh commandment at our next meeting. I hope you join me for that. Let's continue now with praying together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Thank you so much for joining me. And until next time, the Lord be with you.